I'm gonna be talking about mesh networking. A little bit of background about me. I have kind of given a version, well, it's actually not the same version, but I've given mesh networking kind of intros at the past. This will be my third year at PorcFest, kind of giving overviews of what mesh networking is. Previous times have been with other people, and it's been more kind of just open-ended where people ask questions and we answer them to the best of our knowledge, but I kind of put together an actual presentation this time. So I got interested in this whole thing, in mesh networking, I guess, through my interest in freedom, so like being a part of this kind of community, and also just being interested in finding the actual solutions to those freedoms through technology, because technology is probably one of the best ways we're gonna be able to find the freedoms that we want. I have big concerns with like large corporate things, so I think, you know, creating systems that can replace them or give options to not use them is very essential in moving forward and developing a more free world. I previously worked at a startup called Open Garden, and I was kind of their community manager for a couple of years. They built a kind of an application that allowed you to share internet access between phones, and they also built this application called Fire Chat, which got really big in Hong Kong when they were nervous about the government shutting the internet off. So they were using this application, which was essentially a chat application that you could use with people nearby without accessing the internet directly. So it would use like Bluetooth radio, for example. And I quit there over a year now, mostly because they weren't open source and I was kind of like pushing for that for a while and it wasn't really happening. So our interests kind of went separate ways. So I left and now I work for a company called MadeSafe. They're not mesh networking related per se, but they do, they are working on decentralizing the internet in another way. So maybe I'll touch on that at the end, because to decentralize the internet means fixing various problems with it. So, and mesh networking is kind of just one of those problems to solve. So, yeah, I'll dive into it. So this is like mesh networking 101. I'll give a brief overview of like my knowledge of it and obviously why I think we need to be thinking about different infrastructures and potentially like how everyone here can think about potentially making a mesh network in their own community, or even for next year's PorcFest, we kind of tried to organize something, but it didn't really come together. I think we need to like set a little bit of set the motion going at this year's PorcFest for next year's PorcFest. So what's the problem? We have centralization of communications. I think it's about 18 out of the 50 states in the US where Comcast is the main ISP. And I think it's similar, maybe like 10 or 15 where Time Warner is the main ISP. And you may or may not know that they were threatening to merge earlier this year, last year. Which would be like horrendous, because that would be essentially most of the country states being controlled by a single corporation for people's access to the internet. So that's essentially like what we're trying to do here is to avoid these monopolies that are controlling our access to the internet and our access to information. There don't only exist monopolized ISPs. There are smaller ISPs. For example, where I'm from in San Francisco, there's a couple of smaller ISPs. One's called Monkey Brains and the other one's called Sonic.net. Sonic.net has actually been around for I think 2 decades now. And they're just essentially like a good company. They haven't like decided to merge with any other ISP, and they've kind of kept good standards. They, I use their service, even though it's not necessarily as fast as Comcast might be sometimes, particularly because they have good standards with privacy. So there is actually a federal minimum of logs that ISPs have to keep, and they keep the minimum, which is 2 weeks. Comcast and, you know, Time Warner, they keep years and years worth of logs of internet traffic. So, so their terms of services are great, and they're just really honest people, which is so, I enjoy using their service, but that just doesn't necessarily scale. Like, the honesty doesn't necessarily scale. And sure, you can have like centralized systems that, you know, maybe there's a small ISP providing internet to the community, and you can kind of trust that one company because they're, you know, within your community and you might know them. But as soon as you start reaching out and trying to make things more efficient for that company, you begin to lose trust. You begin to lose like knowing who they are, knowing what their motives are. If they're starting to take in a lot of money, then maybe their interest can shift towards being more interested in, you know, provide, potentially merging and making a lot of money through merging with Comcast or something. So small ISPs aren't a problem. They're just like not necessarily the answer either. So I'm gonna kind of relate ISPs to parasites, because I think that's, and just like generally the state, it's like this thing that is pervasive, and we kind of need to think smarter than the parasites to protect ourselves. We can't necessarily just like build up this wall that's protecting us from them. We have to kind of be smart about it, and by building kind of infrastructure that's decentralized, we can just outsmart them without, you know, building up huge walls that take a lot of energy and resources that could potentially just end up being knocked down, and then we're back at square one. So it is also important to note that mesh networking isn't necessarily a solution to security. Mesh networking is a solution to access to the internet. It's a solution to access to communications. If you're really interested in security, there's other tools for that, like obviously encryption and just a lot of other tools. I'll talk about maybe some of those tools quickly at the end, but just kind of keep in the back of your head, this is about like just taking the power away from these central corporations. And so what the effects that these ISPs have on our society is obviously cost. So the biggest thing is cost, right? So, or at least the most obvious thing is cost. It's what like the media talks about. It's what you read in the news. And it's a huge problem because people that can't afford to access the internet, it's actually, you're preventing them from being able to, you know, progress as a person and learn and take in knowledge. So cost is really important, and it's actually quite ironic, but in Europe, they're costs for internet access are significantly lower than America. And why is that? Because the state enforces competition. But that doesn't really mean anything. But it is actually pushing the costs down. So what they do is they force the large ISPs to lease out their infrastructure to smaller companies so that they can drive the price down. So that's kind of like this, you know, pseudo solution that they've come to that is like helpful for obviously for people that can't afford internet access. They'll be able to afford it a lot easier being in Europe. But for example, there's a lot of crazy talk by Cameron in the UK about banning encryption and all this, and just the fact that the state is attempting to solve these problems is just putting all of the control into the state. And even with the ISPs, like the smaller ISPs using the larger ISPs infrastructure, it's still centralized. You're still centralized around this main ISP infrastructure. So it's not really a solution, but it is, the situation is better than it is in America because they don't have they have these larger states, they have these more encroaching states, so they are finding solutions, but I don't see that being long-term sustainable at all. And then also what's really important about taking power away from ISPs is that they control access to content and information. So Comcast and NBC are the same. They're all pretty much the same. So we are essentially depending on these ISPs to make sure that we have access to content. And then it gets really tricky with net neutrality because we want to kind of have access to all different kinds of content, and we don't want the ISPs to take that away. We don't necessarily want, our group doesn't necessarily want to regulate that away with the state, but there does need to be alternative solutions so that major corporations aren't actively blocking websites like WikiLeaks or something, just for, whatever, just because they want to. So there are, this whole mesh networking ISP thing is a really tricky subject when you're talking about being kind of in anarchist communities, because there are, it is, maybe I'll talk about it at the end, but it is the fact that, the internet and access to the internet is kind of this common good, similar to water and stuff. That's where it gets really tricky. And then I just again reiterate that it's not about security. So for example, decentralized networks like Bitcoin, that's decentralized, that's cool, but it's not private or it's secure in that it's, you're not going to hack the actual network, but it's not secure in that you're not going to get your Bitcoin stolen, or you're going to stay anonymous. Similar with BitTorrent, it's not secure. It's just taking the power away from the central corporations. So you need the security in addition to the decentralization for this whole thing to work. Okay. So, and then now I'll just talk about mesh networks and what they are. So mesh networks are essentially infrastructures that are based on peer-to-peer communication. So instead of instead of one ISP kind of connecting to everyone's home routers and everyone having their own connection to the ISP and it going up to the ISP and back down to another router, if you're trying to talk to someone else, even your neighbor, you're still going up through the ISP and back down. The idea with mesh networks is why not just avoid going up through them and back down and just connect directly with each other? For sharing any sort of information, but also for internet access. So I mentioned Open Garden a little bit. I'll talk about that after. So the biggest push that I've seen for mesh networking has actually been in communities. There have been several decades old communities that have been pushing for kind of peer-to-peer connectivity when they're within their homes, within with the people that they care about, because there just isn't, there isn't infrastructure where they are, so they're just essentially building it themselves. And so mesh networks create this peer-to-peer network where you can kind of route information, and the information will find kind of the quickest path to the destination that you're trying to go to. You can do this in a couple different ways. There's a bunch of different protocols that use this, and I'll go over a couple. But you can essentially, like, there's one way you can like flood the network and kind of try to get the information to the destination by flooding the network and finding as many paths as possible. And then there's other ways that are a little more intelligent that don't necessarily require flooding the entire network. So so you can use like phones and computers for nodes, but for mesh network nodes, but the most beneficial and the most efficient are routers, because they're built for routing communications. So the routers that we have today are one directional. So internet comes in through the ISP and goes out to your devices. There's no internet, and then you connect back to that router and go back up to the ISP. There isn't any way for those routers to connect to each other the way that they are, because all of the routers that you have, all of the operating systems that run on them are closed source, so you can't really modify what's going on. But there are solutions to this. So before I talk about the open source stuff, there are kind of mesh networks in business as well. So like hotels or like large factories will set up mesh networks, but they're not necessarily interested in like freedom from ISPs. They're just interested in getting the information spread out throughout buildings more efficiently. So there's like Meraki, which got acquired by Cisco, and there's this thing called OpenMesh, but they're not really open. And so it's a step in the right direction. Like, it's providing the actual technology you can use to connect routers kind of peer-to-peer, but they're still closed and you can't really modify what's going on within them. So I say start with open standards. So there's this operating system for routers called OpenWRT, and it's essentially Linux for routers. And you can, you know, play around with it. You can install whatever you want in it. And that's essentially where a lot of the communities start with. And then from there, you can install different kinds of protocols that actually do the peer-to-peer connections. I have three on here. The OLSR is an older protocol, and it uses that like flooding technique to kind of find as many peers as possible and flood the network with the information so it can get to the destination fast. But it requires that the whole like network is kind of synced. So it works well, but it's not necessarily the most efficient in terms of using power and needing to flood the network. Ideally, you have something a little more intelligent. And that's kind of where Batman came into play. That's the logo for the bat guy. So their goal is to kind of replace OLSR through a more efficient routing protocol. It kind of finds the best route by sharing just a little bit of information, but it doesn't require that all the nodes know what's going on. A node kind of sends like the direction that it needs to go in, or sorry, the direction that it came from, the information came from, and then that node should know where to go next. And so it kind of keeps the information more decentralized, actually, because you're not needing to tell every single node what's going on. And then there's kind of building on top of that, there's CJDNS, which is really interesting because they actually are, they're more philosophically driven. They think that the security should be built in. So they all of their communications are encrypted by default. It doesn't necessarily mean that it is the best solution because they do still, as far as I know, there are still ways to be susceptible to types of attacks on the network. So at least with the routing protocols that they are using, so they're basically, if you know what a DHT is, a distributed hash table, they're building off of something like that, which is susceptible to attacks where if you flood the entire network with nodes, if a single entity does that, then there's ways to kind of get around the security and compromise security. But they use cryptography and they're very into security. So those are kind of just like, that's kind of the range, I guess. There are other protocols as well, called like Babel and there's a couple others. But this is kind of what a lot of the communities are doing. They're working with different protocols to be able to connect home routers to each other by flashing them with a new operating system and installing a new protocol that they all use the same protocol within the community. So just to touch on Open Garden and like the potential of using mesh networks in mobile devices. So as I said, Open Garden has they have their application that's called Open Garden, that's just for sharing internet access. So it's kind of like tethering. So if you need internet access on your laptop, you can tether with Open Garden. However, in addition, you can go backwards, you can route information through multiple hops. So it does create this mesh network, but it is limited by the fact that it's mobile phones aren't routers. Like they are, but they're not. Like they can route through Bluetooth and like Wi-Fi direct type radios, but those aren't efficient for long distance at all. So those types of situations work really well for even places like here where we're all in close proximity and we're within Bluetooth range. If we all had an application on our phones, we could kind of share internet with each other. And then Open Garden also made this FireChat application, which I mentioned, that is for, it's not about accessing the internet, it's just like a local service where you can connect and chat with it without needing to talk to any internet. And then there's also Serval. I haven't really looked into them recently. I know they were doing like a Kickstarter for this like mesh extender thing. I don't think it was successful, but they're kind of like the open source version of Open Garden, or they're trying to be. I don't know if they have as good mesh technology, but they're kind of using different ways to at least help phones talk directly to each other. So I'll talk about a couple of the communities because I think the communities are really interesting. So Freifunk, they're in Germany, and it's actually Germany-wide. So there's a bunch of different Freifunk communities. So I had the pleasure of meeting a couple of the Berlin Freifunk people, and they basically have their own, you know, Freifunk mesh network set up in Berlin. And then similarly, and so they have, let's see, they have, oh, and Freifunk means free radio, which is cool. And they also maintain Batman, the protocol that I was saying. So they use Batman, and then they just, because they want to see it get better, they also maintain it, and they do it by donation. And they might be sponsored, but I can't say for sure. I think mostly it's kind of a community-driven maintaining of Batman protocol. But Freifunk has about 150 separate communities, mostly in Germany. They might span out into Austria, maybe in Amsterdam, I'm not sure. But they have almost 10,000 access points within the Freifunk community. And then Hamburg is the biggest community, which has about 720 access points. So essentially, you go to Hamburg and you find one of these access points and you connect to the internet for free, and they just spray free internet all over the city. Like, this is what I'm talking about. This is what should happen. And they, Freifunk, they actually started in 2002. So it's pretty old. Similarly, there's a community in Athens that started at a similar time. And they're kind of known to be the oldest mesh networking community. They started because they just had limited bandwidth. They didn't have the right infrastructure, so they were the ones that kind of just started building it themselves. And then, so Slovenia is cool. They have a different approach. Their approach is to kind of make it as easy as possible to join. So a lot of these communities, you need to like go to their meetups and bring a router and be like, teach me how to flash this, or they'll help you or some, or they'll do it for you maybe. But Slovenia is kind of going the route of like making it as easy as possible, and removing need for tech skills. So they have this thing called Node Watcher, which is kind of a centralized point in the system. Good or bad, I'm not sure. But the Node Watcher kind of is the centralized web interface that enables anyone to just like kind of buy a router and then plug into it and like choose their options, and they're good to go. And it also helps users kind of understand what's happening with their node, so they can kind of understand what's going on in general more. Gwifi.net is, they're in Catalonia, and they are the largest ISP community. They kind of have, I think they've been able to kind of partner with a couple of companies there, which is why they've been able to grow and kind of fund themselves. But they've only been around since 2009, and they have 27,000 active nodes, which essentially covers like all of Catalonia. They basically have free internet in Catalonia, like for everyone. And that covers, 36,000 kilometers of wireless links. And then finally, I just wanted to touch on the Oakland Mesh Network. They're not necessarily big or anything. I'm just a little biased towards them because they're my hometown. And they started in 2011. They kind of took a year break or so. They didn't have enough kind of community effort, but they started diving back in like 2 years ago, and they're working on, they've kind of built their own firmware, and right now they're working on deploying it. So they're not really at a stage where it's like super operable, but they're kind of in this middle stage of deploying and testing, which is a really interesting thing to witness. And they get to like go out and mount nodes and like, you know, climb people's houses and stuff. And I guess it's also relevant to say that most of these networks have street level nodes, so like the home routers, but then they also have backbone nodes that are kind of point to point. They're more reliable, more resilient, because they have more bandwidth going across to the backbone. It does kind of centralize it a little bit, but it does create a lot more efficiency, and you're not completely centralizing it because you have many backbone nodes and you can fall back on different backbone nodes, but it essentially just helps spread the wireless out a little better than if you were to just have street level nodes and home routers connecting to each other. So it's kind of like this tiered thing, almost a little higher. I guess it's two levels of hierarchy, but the top level isn't a central point, so that's better than an ISP. And then maybe just like, I don't know if this is super relevant, but just like a shout out to the Internet Archive. They actually have a, they have a 70-foot tower in Richmond, California that just sprays internet to everyone. And it's like Richmond, California is low income. So they're actually doing the best that they can to spread that that Wi-Fi out with kind of repeaters and whatnot. It is kind of a centralized point. So if that went down, then other people wouldn't be able to use it. But the idea with that would be to add that into other people's internet. So that would be like the main source, but if that went down, you could still use other people's internet. And these communities are actually really, even though they're super about kind of working together in this community effort, and this, none of this stuff is about making money. Like, none of these people are interested in this for profit. This is not like a capitalist driven thing at all. But they are really into competition because they want to have the best technology possible. So they actually meet every year. This will be the eighth year that they're meeting. It's just all of the communities come together in one spot and they do a battle mesh and they test their technologies against each other. They set up mesh networks and kind of see who's better and help each other because everyone like wants to kind of improve this situation, not just for their communities, but it's also just, it's fun time talking to other mesh people. So if you want to, so this one's actually in Slovenia. If you have any interest to go to Slovenia, I highly recommend it. I'm going, so I encourage you to go. They have a lot of different, at the bottom, I don't know if you can see. Yeah, there's a couple, like you can see some of the, logos that I had up, they're some of the same ones down at the bottom. So it's essentially these communities coming together and just teaching other people. It's not just for like just techies, it's for enthusiasts too. So I guess I'm just going to end on a little of why again and like maybe some philosophy that might be controversial, I don't know. So knowledge is freedom. Why we need mesh networks is so that we can give freedom to people that can't right now access that knowledge because they don't have access to the internet. Whether or not you like it, things like internet access are kind of like a shared common good. There is a way to reach a place where we don't have scarcity in internet access, in bandwidth. Like scarcity and bandwidth can be completely removed from the picture. And without scarcity, you don't need any sort of like kind of market capital driven motive to see it happen. If everyone can just have it, then we're good. Like, and that's something that we should be striving for. I can see maybe like in the meantime, trying to set up some of these mesh networks, maybe experimenting with like, there have been some ideas with like using a cryptocurrency to incentivize setting up nodes in a mesh network. So instead of like mining Bitcoin, you're sharing internet access and you earn a cryptocurrency. I think that could be a fun experiment, but I don't think in the end that we're gonna need that at all. I mean, I think I think we can kind of just surpass that and just, I mean, but not, I mean, not just completely write it off. I think it would be cool to experiment with, but I don't think in the end that's going to be the solution for most communities. I mean, if you want to do that within your community, go for it. But I think most communities will be like, that whole token thing, maybe we should just get rid of it and just share internet. So with that said, I guess it removes, mesh networks provide independence from monopolies, but it also puts on dependence with each other. So we do kind of have to rely more on each other, which isn't a bad thing if you're talking about communities, right? Because that's what mesh networks are about. Like, mesh networks are actual like proximity communication things. So if you're setting up a community mesh network, you're gonna know the people in your, or hopefully know the people in your community, and be able to figure out a way to provide these services equally and fairly. I say internet can be a public service. Why not? But a public service that isn't like mandated or regulated, state regulated or anything like that, because that's a huge problem. But also, in addition to internet access, mesh networks provide really cool local services. So for PorcFest, what if we had a mesh network set up and we put the schedule on there, and maybe a bulletin board, a chat thing, but all of that was hosted on a server here. We wouldn't even need to like talk to the internet. We wouldn't need to be wasting bandwidth at all if we just like set up a infrastructure, which is really easy if we can kind of come together beforehand and plan it. We did try a little bit to plan something for this year, but I think it was a little too last minute, and I think if we kind of get a little more organized, we can have something better for next year, or even better, if you guys want to start thinking about it for your own communities, then you can start thinking about how you would implement that, and then, you know, bring that to PorcFest next year. Yeah, and then also another local service that's really important is emergency situations. Like, what if the internet goes off? Like, you still want to be able to communicate with your neighbors. Like, what if there could be some sort of emergency broadcast that's completely localized, and it uses a mesh network to kind of alert people. So there's a lot of applications for this that kind of come down to removing the centralized monopolies, the centralized ISPs. So that's kind of it. I guess I wanted to touch on the fact that mesh networks aren't the only solution to fixing how we use the internet. There are still other problems like security, like the fact that most of our communication is completely clear text is a huge problem. And then also that we depend on servers. Like, servers are essentially centralized things. Google, if you upload anything to Google, you're depending on their servers, or Dropbox or anything like that. So, and that's kind of where MadeSafe comes into play. That's why I'm really excited to be working for MadeSafe. We're working to remove the dependence from the server part. So that's kind of like the other really important thing that, and we're doing the security thing too. So our interest as a company is to work with community mesh networks more in the future and mesh networks in general to kind of bring all of these pieces together and hopefully build an alternate internet that is, you know, secure and private and decentralized from points of control. Everyone, I don't know, if are people interested in participating in like either building a mesh network, maybe building a mesh network in their community or for next year's PorcFest? Like, can we raise our hands? Cool. So, we should, what are you guys doing at 2 on Saturday? I propose a kind of a duo, just completely off the schedule thing. At 2 p.m., I'm going to, I don't know, I guess I'll go over there on Saturday under those, that tent. Hopefully there won't be a lot of people there, but you can look for me. So we're going to talk about how we can delegate, like, what people are interested in doing and build, like, if you're a developer, maybe you can help play around with things. Ryan has been playing around with a lot of routers and stuff, so he can kind of talk about what he's been doing. And I know there's a lot of other networking people here that are really smart, so maybe we can all come together at 2 on Saturday in the field, and then if it's not a good location, we can move somewhere else. But in addition to that, I also want to do like a crypto party thing. So if you're interested in like learning about like Tor or PGP or anything, I'd like to help people learn that. And two more announcements, and then I'll take questions. Yeah, so maybe even 1 p.m., because,
New Hampshire Engineers for Liberty, or Freedom Engineers, is meeting up at 1 p.m.
Okay.
At the Upper Picnic Dock.
Okay.
So it'll be right after that.
Okay, so maybe, okay, that would be good. So maybe right after that, then. So 2 p.m. after that event. What tent did you say it was? Up there, probably.
Mesh networking can be a topic there.
Okay, so let's go up there instead. At 2. Sorry to confuse everyone. So let's go to the Upper Picnic Tent at 2 and try to get all those engineers involved as well. And also, I think it's at 5, maybe it's at 6. I also just wanted to give a shout out on Friday. There's a talk by Brian Sovereign, who's talking about dark Android. So if you want to learn about potentially making your phone secure or dark, he has a lot of cool tricks to do that. He's been kind of putting a blog together, so just shout out to him and for that. And then also at 4, so after our mesh crypto meeting at 2, at 4, there's Sovereign Tech, which is Brian Sovereign's podcast. It'll be live in the media room, and he talks a lot about technology and stuff, so I think I'll probably be on the show, but if you want to like hear, if you haven't heard that podcast, I highly recommend like coming up and talking and hanging out with the community up there at 4 on Saturday. And that'll end my talk, so if you have any questions? I don't know what time it is. Oh, cool. Wow, good timing.
Yeah, where the technology limits at, it's been a while since I looked at mesh networks, so the technology limits, they're hitting. And in Catalonia or the other places, what are the bandwidths that they're getting, download, upload speeds?
You know, I don't know the specifics of the speeds on these networks. I know that Catalonia is essentially like the ISP for, like, it is the, they are providing internet services for the community, like that whole area, so it's significant enough. I don't know the exact speeds though. It's, they all have websites and they all have a lot more information than what I said. The barriers, I think, with these community projects are getting, I think it depends on where they are actually. I think in Oakland it's been hard because a lot of the people, including myself, have been like interested in helping but not having enough time and like dropping out and kind of coming back, and it's really hard to kind of build firmware and deploy these types of things with not a set group of people. That they do have a set group of people, but it's just very small, and then there's just other people that kind of filter in and out. But generally, with the other networks, I don't think there's necessarily much wrong with them. I think they're growing at a steady pace, and you know, maybe there's less interest in the European ones because ISP prices are lower. So people aren't, might not be as interested in setting up a node because it's only $15 for internet, so whatever. So I think maybe like kind of driving the philosophy behind it might be the kind of biggest hurdle. They do, but they also have their own local services. So, So aren't the ISP, aren't these communities connecting to the ISPs anyway? So yeah, it is kind of like, we are kind of still depending on the ISPs for the actual internet access, but they do have like their local services that they run. So if you want to kind of set up a map or something and make that completely local without, yeah, but that said, if enough communities do this, we don't need, like, why, we don't need the ISPs. If we're just, if we start connecting to the communities to each other, or if we start deploying, like, satellites, and kind of making those, like, backbones, there's a lot of options. But, yeah, in the end, a lot of these communities are essentially just, connecting through the ISPs back to.
Are the ISPs aware of what's happening?
Sometimes. Well, in the US, like Verizon and Comcast, it's against their terms of service to share your internet access. So they are kind of aware of certain things. I can't say that, like, I know much, like, if they've taken action against the communities or anything. I haven't heard anything big about it. I mean, maybe the states are kind of seeing it and implementing more of these regulations to make the ISPs seem better because there's more competition or something. But, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I've enjoyed Fire Chat. I've been a fan of it since, you know, the Hong Kong things. I haven't really used it too much because it's not as useful where I am. But just in terms of secure private communication, it's not really as Fire Chat, which is a group networking messaging thing. What do you have as personal preferences or recommendations? Like, I like Wickr, but nobody's on it.
Secure communications?
Yeah.
I use TextSecure for texting.
Yeah.
For
Red Phone, probably.
Yeah, I use Red Phone. I mean, I don't really use like a chat. I don't really use chats that much. So like, I honestly, most of the stuff I say, like, I don't mind it being not secure. Like, if I'm saying something quickly to someone on like a Twitter or DM, it's like not the biggest deal. But if I want it to be secure, I use PGP or there's actually this cool, but really nerdy and hard to install software called Pond, which only works over Tor. So if you don't have Tor running, it won't work. But essentially, it's kind of like a replacement for email, but it's more secure than PGP because it changes your keys consistently. And because the problem with PGP is that you have one key, and if that's compromised, then you're screwed. So
how would they recognize if your key is shifting?
So it's kind of like based on a C key, like the key's kind of C next ones. I can't say that I know too much of the technology, but it's this concept called forward secrecy, where keys just constantly change for each message. I think, yeah, Chris. Or
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay, Chris.
You seem kind of really down on incentives for running routers in the network. I just wonder. Because it seems like they could scale beyond just local communities.
Yeah. But they could also be taken advantage of. I don't know. Bitcoin's kind of a bummer to me because of how it's been like taken over by corporate crap. So I don't know. That stuff kind of brings me down, and I don't want to see that happen to internet access. I think that could be the question. Sorry, the question was like, he was just saying I seem kind of down with the whole like incentive structure. potentially like incentivizing nodes for setting up a mesh network. It could be a good idea, but it could be taken advantage of. And okay, so the main problem with that is if you set up a node and then you set up another node and then you just start using your own node to access the internet and then you just start earning this mesh coin, you just force the network, you're like, oh, I'm using this other node's internet, but it's really me, so I'm forcing the network to pay me this coin, and it just gets really, really complicated. And but again, I also don't necessarily think we need it. It could be cool to experiment with. I'm not knocking experimenting with it.
Yeah. Isn't that what MateSafe coin is?
Yeah. Yeah, so MateSafe uses a crypto token to incentivize setting up nodes for sharing disk space and processing power. Yeah, it definitely, it helps. So it helps, okay, so I'm definitely not knocking the cryptocurrency concept of incentivizing nodes. I guess just like in the long run, I'd like to see all that stuff go away, and for things that aren't based on scarcity, so internet access can potentially, like bandwidth can potentially be post-scarcity type situation. Similar to storage, data storage, like eventually we can just have enough data capacity that we don't need to incentivize each other to do this. But yeah, so cryptocurrencies can prove to be helpful, but I think they have to be done in a smart way. But yeah.
It seems like a lot of the appeal for this, you know, is outward access to the internet, but and maybe this is my own skepticism, I feel like that's also kind of the weakest link, because you've got to get people to share their bandwidth. If I wanted to create a network in my community, like a small city, what is the state of applications that run on the local network that I could, you know, pitch to communities, especially people that aren't maybe super technical? Because I feel like a lot of this would be really, like, it's a really cool idea to me.
Yeah.
But if I want to get the community, like a town network or something like that out there, what's out there that I could, you know,
so what the question was, like, what is out there for communities to look into and use? So essentially what the other communities are doing, they all have different ideas. So looking, so it is like you do want to start with this open standard idea and using OpenWRT. I can't say that they've necessarily reached making it a situation where it's like super easy and like anyone can do it kind of thing. Maybe Slovenia might want to look into what they're doing with their that central service that I mentioned. That
I
forget.
This is like applications. You're talking about fireside chat.
But yeah, there aren't many applications. So, I mean, yeah, there aren't many applications. So there's Serval, which is an open source version, and or an open source application, and they have different like applications within it, so you can kind of chat or share internet access, but I honestly haven't looked at the state of that in the past year. So there aren't many applications that you can download and use easily. It's a very underdeveloped kind of in a commercial sense, because it's hard to make money on building this kind of infrastructure.
What about setting up an HTTP or XMPP server for communications within the local network, within the mesh?
Yeah. Setting up just setting up servers within the mesh for local services.
For XMPP and HTTP,
yeah.
So you can do websites and chat.
Yeah, so you could, it would require, it's not an app that you can install, but you would be able to set up something like a local server that would enable people to just use their browsers to access it. But that would require you kind of setting up the server and hopefully decentralizing the server a little bit, because then that creates a central point. Okay, I'm done, but you can talk to me later and come to the Mesh Crypto Extravaganza at the top tent camp picnic site.